आणि आवाज येतो का? हॅलो, ओके. सो इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस लॅटिस ट्रान्सलेशन वेक्टर अँड रूट सेल. ऍक्च्युली वी हॅव डिस्कस्ड लॅटिस अँड वी वर डिस्कसिंग ट्रान्सलेशन वेक्टर्स. ओके, सो लेट अस हॅव द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड हियर अँड यू विल फाइंड दॅट what is a lattice. Why lattice is the very first sentence that it is easy way to understand. It is easy way to understand the arrangement of atoms in a crystal. Because what is crystal? Crystal is a regular periodic arrangement of atoms or molecules, and how these atoms are arranged periodically, that should be understood, that will be easily understood if we are familiar with the concept of lattice. Now, what is lattice? Lattice is a totally imaginary concept. Lattice is totally imaginary concept. That means it will not happen. It is not a natural or real. It is a complete imaginary and mathematical concept. And same thing is clear from the definition of the lattice. What definition says that it is an arrangement of infinite number of imaginary points in a space where each point has identical surrounding, and okay, such an arrangement is known as point lattice or space lattice. Point lattice, space lattice, lattice, these are same names of the same concept, that is imaginary concept, and that is lattice. So arrangement of infinite number of imaginary points in the space where each point has identical surrounding. So what is identical? What do we mean by identical surrounding? So identical surrounding means when we observe a lattice, so you will find here the image of a lattice, and you will find that there are a number of points are here. So this is a lattice point, this is a lattice point, and the arrangements of these lattice points, arrangement of these points is periodical. So after a certain distance, we will find that a lattice point is repeated. After a certain distance, a lattice point is repeated. After a certain distance, lattice point is repeated. So in all direction, a periodical distance is there and the lattice point is repeated. So this is a periodical arrangement of imaginary points. These never exist in a crystal. These are imaginary points. Okay, so this such type of arrangement of imaginary points is called as lattice. Now, every point has identical surrounding. What is mean by identical surrounding? Let us consider here one point that is represented by a position of this point is represented by a position vector r prime, and position of this point, another one that is represented by a position vector r with a certain arbitrary origin. Okay, so a lattice point, lattice is said to possess identical surrounding if this position vector r prime can be written in can be represented in terms of position vector r. Position r prime can be represented in terms of position r, okay, by means of an operation that is given here, that is vector t equal to n1a plus n2b plus n3c, which is called as translation operation, where a, b and c are known as fundamental translation vectors, and n1, n2, n3 are simply numbers, simply integers. Okay, now let us move to the another slide. So here you will find that when so we will have here an equation. Actually, yes, here is r prime equal to r plus t equal to r plus n1a plus n2b plus n3c. That means position r prime can be obtained from position r simply by operating operation r, as here it is shown by adding a vector t, translation vector t. So when translation vector t operates on position vector r, we get a position vector r prime. When such thing happens in a lattice, that in which r prime can be obtained from position vector r by using this equation, such lattice is called as perfect lattice. Now, what is an imperfect lattice? A lattice is said to be imperfect lattice when it is not possible to represent a position r prime in terms of r by using the operation t as it has it was happening in a perfect lattice. So in perfect lattice it is not possible to have not possible to find the position vectors a, b and c such that arbitrary choice of integers n1 and n2 n1 n2 and n3 makes r prime identical to vector r. Okay, so perfect lattice, perfect lattice is one in which any position r prime can be represented by r, that means each point has identical surrounding. Very simple. And imperfect lattice is one in which r prime cannot be represented in r, that means that it doesn't have, every point doesn't have identical surrounding. Okay, so it is quite clear here. Okay, so now let us move to another point. So this a, b and c are the unit vectors actually along the three different axes, because we know the crystal is a three dimensional geometry. It is a three dimensional figure where x, y, z, where for example say vector a is unit vector along x axis, vector b is along y axis, c is along z axis. So these are the three different axes of the crystal which are shown in the lattice. So these are called as crystal axes, or simply these are, since these are the vectors, these are called as basis vector. So what is a basis? So that we will see in the next coming articles, after one or more articles, okay, in the same chapter. So so you will find here it is a two-dimensional lattice. Okay, two-dimensional lattice. So points are along horizontal and points are along vertical axis. So x-axis, the vectors, basis vector or lattice, crystal axis along x-axis are represented by a1 and a2, and crystal axis along y-axis are represented by b1 and b2. Accordingly, we have shown here the two positions by position vector r and vector r prime. And let us see how we will find a vector r prime from vector r by using the translation operation. Now, translation operation depends upon choice of the vectors. Suppose we have selected a pair of vectors a1 and b1. a1 is along x-axis, b1 is along y-axis. Now, if these are selected, then what about the values of the coefficients n1 and n2? You will find that, so n1 has coefficient a0 and n2 has coefficient 1. So we will have translation operation t as equal to 0 a1 plus 1 b1. So r prime can be obtained from r by simply adding operation t, and we will have r plus 0 a1 plus 1 b1. On the other hand, if we select a pair a2 and b2, then the choice will be different. It will be half. So half a2 plus half b2. So here coefficients, coefficient n1 and n2 both are same, and those are 1 by 2. Here 0 and 1 are integers. Here these both n1 and n2 are 1 by 2 and fractional numbers. These are non-integers. So important one is that when a1 and b1, as in the first case, are has integral coefficients 0 and 1, and therefore these are such type of vectors, fundamental translation vectors which has integral coefficients, these are known as primitive translation vectors. On the other hand, the vectors a2 and b2, which has fractional numbers, non-integral coefficients, 1 by 2, fractional numbers, and therefore these are called as non-primitive translation vectors. So there are two types of fundamental translation vectors, primitive translation vectors and non-primitive translation vectors. Primitive translation vector simply has a coefficients as integers, and non-primitive translation vector simply has coefficients as non-integers, say fraction numbers. Okay, so important to note two points: that non-primitive translation vectors are not accordance with the periodicity of the crystal. That means, okay, if we consider non-primitive translation vectors for a lattice, then it is not according to periodicity of the lattice. Okay, so it will not repeat in all directions after a specific distance. Okay, and another one is that the shortest possible translation vector. Okay, so which translation vector we have to select while defining lattice? So shortest possible translation vectors were selected to describe a lattice. Now let us move to another slide. So here it is a unit cell. next part is unit cell. We have already studied lattice and translation vector. Now let us move to unit cell. So we have seen that there are fundamental translation vectors A, B and C. Okay, if it is three dimensional lattice, there will be three fundamental translation vectors A, B and C. If it is a two dimensional lattice, there will be two fundamental translation vectors only, as we have seen in the previous example, A and B. Now, if we consider a figure bounded by a translation vector, what will it be? Okay, so for example, if there are only two translation vectors, then figure bounded by this translation vector will simply be a parallelogram. Okay, and this, when this parallelogram will repeat, it will, okay, so let us see here. So we will see in the next slide the figure. So parallelogram formed by translation vector which can be repeated to construct the complete lattice. Okay, so that is called as unit cell. So if it is three dimensional lattice, then it will never be a parallelogram. It will have the third axis. Okay, it is a three dimensional figure bounded by six parallelograms. That is called as parallelopiped. Okay, so 3D lattice, there will be parallelopiped. Okay, unit cell in two dimensional will be parallelogram, and in three dimensional will be parallelopiped. And important point one has to note that if we repeat this unit cell in all direction, we will find a complete lattice. Okay, in two dimensional lattice, if the parallelogram is repeated in all directions, we will find a complete lattice. In three dimensional lattice, if parallelopiped is repeated in all directions, we will find a 3D lattice. Now, and repetition will simply occurs by applying a translation operation T equal to N1A plus N2B plus N3C. Okay, and what will it do? It will take the unit cell to the another region. Okay, so when translation operation is operated on unit cell, we will move to another region. And again translated, we will move to another region. And in this way, on repeatedly applying the translation operation T, in all directions, we can reproduce the complete lattice. And hence we can define, we have a definition in a single sentence that the smallest unit of the lattice which on continuous repetition can generate a complete lattice is called as unit cell. Okay, so what is unit cell? Smallest unit of the lattice which on continuous repetition generate a complete lattice, that is called as a unit cell. The unit cell is formed, unit cell may be formed by primitive translation vectors, and unit cell may be formed by non-primitive translation vectors. If a unit cell is bounded by primitive translation vector, it is called as primitive unit cell. Unit cell is formed by non-primitive translation vectors is called as non-primitive unit cell. Not only about the names, the difference lies in the complete, what you say, appearance of the unit cell. Let us look at here. So you will find, now look at the figure here, you will find that A, B, C, D, it is a complete lattice, and A, B, C, D is the unit cell. Okay, you will find that this A, B, C, D is the unit cell that is bounded by primitive translation vectors. So it is a primitive cell. Now what about this unit cell E, F, G, H? So this has non-primitive translation vector, as we have seen, which have non-integral coefficients 1 by 2 1 by 2. So this is a non-primitive, this is a unit cell bounded by non-primitive translation vector. So this is the non-primitive unit cell denoted by letter NP. Same we have here unit cell, another unit cell KLMN bounded by non-primitive unit vector. So this is another non-primitive unit cell. What are the characteristics of primitive unit cell, and what are the characteristics of non-primitive unit cell? Important one is that smallest primitive unit cell is the smallest volume cell. It has the least volume. Okay, so it is the least volume cell. Another point is, all lattice points of the primitive unit cell are at the corners. Okay, so you will find that there are no lattice point on the sides or on the inside the cell. So these are simply at the corners only. Okay, and since they are at the corners only, how many number of lattice points per unit cell will be there? Okay, so you will find here. Let us look at the corner C. This corner C, the lattice point at corner C is shared by this unit cell. It is shared by this unit cell. It is shared by this unit cell. Shared by this. 1, 2, 3, 4. These four unit cell will share a single lattice point. So how many one cell will have? 1/4 for this. 1/4 for this. 1/4 for this. 1/4 for this. Similarly, this point B is shared by 4. Similarly, this shared by 4. Shared by 4. So 1/4 plus 1/4 plus 1/4 plus 1/4. 4 × 1/4, that is equal to 1. So this unit cell has only one lattice point. So this is the important characteristics of the primitive unit cell, that it has only one lattice point. Okay, it has only one lattice point per unit cell. Okay. Now what about the non-primitive unit cell? So as we know, non-primitive unit cell is bounded by non-primitive unit vectors. Okay, so this may not be a smallest volume unit. It may be, but it may not be. Almost possibility that it should not have a least volume. Okay, but primitive cell have always a least volume. And important one is that lattice points are at the corners as well as inside the unit cell. Lattice points are at the corners as well as inside the unit cell. So therefore, the number of lattice points per unit cell will be greater than 1. For example, let's look at this EFGH. So 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4 plus 1. Okay, so 4 × 1/4 plus 1, that will be 1 plus 1, that is equal to 2, more than 1. Similarly here, 2 plus 1, 3. 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, 4 × 1/4 plus 1 plus 1. 1 plus 1 plus 1, so 3. Okay, it is greater than 1, 2, it is greater than 1. So effective number of lattice points per unit cell is always greater than 1. So the differences between primitive unit cell and non-primitive unit cell is that primitive unit cell is the least volume cell, smallest volume cell. Non-primitive unit cell is always not, may not be a least volume cell, always not a least volume cell. In primitive unit cell, all lattice points are at the corners. In non-primitive unit cell, the lattice points are at corners, always as inside this, as well as inside the cell. So, since all lattice points are at the corners of the primitive unit cell, the number of lattice points per unit cell is 1 in the primitive unit cell. While, since lattice points are also at the corners as well as inside, so there will be the more that number of 1 lattice points for the non-primitive unit cell. Okay. Now, here we will have a construction of a primitive cell. That construction is given by Wiener and Seitz, so therefore it is called as Wiener and Seitz cell. Okay, so here a lattice is shown. So these are lattice points 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and here it is the 9th one. So there are 9 lattice points in all there. Now, if these are lattice points, how to construct a unit cell? So 3 points are there. Connect given lattice point to the nearby lattice point. Let us consider this lattice point. Connect this lattice point to the all nearby lattice points. So connect. So these are connected by dotted lines. Then next point is draw normal at the midpoints of the line connecting the lattice point. So this is the line joining the nearest lattice point here. And this is the midpoint. So this is the complete length and this is the midpoint. Draw the normal at the midpoint. So normal is drawn. Similarly, so this is the complete line. Here it is the midpoint. Normal is drawn. So all normals are drawn. And the smallest volume that has been enclosed by these normals drawn at the midpoint, okay, of the line joining the lattice points that represent the unit cell. And such type of smallest volume unit cell is called as Wiener-Seitz unit cell. If this unit cell has three different what you say, fundamental translation vectors A, B, and C, if you, since it is a three dimensional, so then volume will be equal to A dot B cross C. This we have seen in the first year, very first, second paper of mathematical physics. So this represents a box product. This represents a box product and a scalar triple product also it is known as. So this represents a volume. So volume of the, what you say, volume of the unit cell, that is called a Wiener seed cell. Now, what is a conventional unit cell? Okay, what is a conventional unit cell? Each lattice has conventional units. Say, for example, hexagonal unit cell, for example, cubic unit cell, that we will see in the next coming articles in the same chapter. So what is a conventional unit cell and how it is selected? Ideally, a primitive unit cell which has smallest volume is chosen as a conventional unit cell. So conventional unit cell is simply a primitive unit cell. Okay, since it has a smallest volume, it is selected. But sometimes the non-primitive unit cell is also selected as a conventional unit cell. So in the next coming article, you will find that hexagonal unit cell, even though it is not a smallest volume, or it is a non-primitive unit cell which has, it doesn't have smallest volume, still it is considered as the conventional unit cell. And it is because the when a non-primitive unit cell is selected, the reason behind is it has more symmetry than the primitive unit cell. Now what is symmetry? That we will see in the next coming article, that is symmetry operations. So thank you, and here